the first episode of Fireside, a look into presidential history with Cam Coyle. My name's Brendo.
Brendo, what are you doing?
Nothing.
Brendo, come on.
You gotta be kidding me.
Hey there, folks. Sorry about that. How's my brother Brendan trying to take over the spotlight? My name is Cameron Coyle, and welcome to the first Fireside episode. We at the Zachary Taylor Project hope that everyone watching this is safe, happy, and healthy today. I know it's been crazy lately with all of this quarantining and social distancing business, but I got some words of encouragement on a run with my dad the other day. He told me that I should start recording myself and tell people the stories that I've been reading about for the past few years. Part of me suspects my dad just wanted me to stop talking his ear off about Zachary Taylor. And I don't blame him. But I took his advice, and with this platform that I've created, I started brainstorming some ideas for this series. I'm going to be talking to you about presidential history. Of course, I'm definitely going to give you some insight into what I've been researching about President Taylor. But in addition, I want to make this series as a really cool intro for those of you who want to learn a little bit more about our country's presidents. I mean, there really isn't much better to do right now. Why not spend a few minutes every week making the days useful? With that said, let's get into it. Why don't you follow me into my library? So, as you may have already noticed by the title, we're going to look at cholera, COVID-19, and the impact of disease on American history. We might not be starting off with the most exciting of topics, but just wait till the end. There's a silver lining. COVID-19 is currently turning our world upside down. We can't travel abroad, much less travel outside of our homes in many cases. But what we can do is travel back in time to see that this type of situation isn't actually that new to us. Diseases have shaped our history in many ways. To say that they've had bad effects on people are a gigantic understatement. By looking at their effects, however, we can see that many important changes and decisions made throughout world history were highly affected by numerous types of diseases. Take, for example, cholera. The illness has a history deeply rooted in our global communications and transactions in centuries past. Even in some third world countries today, like Yemen, cholera continues to have an unfortunate toll on many communities. In the United States, it is certainly treatable, but it hasn't totally gone away yet. So what is cholera? Cholera is an infectious bacterial disease which thrives in unclean conditions. It is most likely to lurk in contaminated water and produce. The CDC advises that to stray away from getting cholera, you should wash your hands, drink and use safe water, and cook food well. Also, improper disposal of sewage and waste increases the risk of someone getting it. So if your water smells funny, you probably shouldn't drink it. Oh, God. I'm not gonna drink this. Nah. Actually, I'm gonna take a sip of water right now. Sip of cholera water. Many people in the 19th century didn't have the choice or the technology to understand and combat cholera. The massive pandemics that the disease was responsible for supposedly had its origins in India in 1817, and ever since has popped up in places all around the world. One of those places was the United States. Cholera first hit American shores in 1832, but the 1849 outbreak shows hysteria at its highest. Immigrants coming from Europe, specifically Ireland and Germany, may have helped revitalize the spread of the disease in towns all across America. The cities along the Mississippi River system got hit the hardest. Cholera took the lives of 4,200 people in St. Louis, and Nashville and Cincinnati reported thousands more cases and deaths. New York City was also heavily affected by the disease. The scary thing about cholera was its mortality rate. Only half that got it survived, and medical professionals scratched their heads on how to solve it. It would be a few years before scientists agreed that cholera came from bad water, and so people had different theories about how the deadly disease came about. Americans were warned that cholera was in the filth on city streets, and that the air was contaminated with it. Some even believe that overindulgence and sinfulness caused the disease to spread. Medical knowledge was pretty shady back then, That was a time when doctors believed that taking morphine and letting leeches hang out all over your body would cure anything. That's, first of all, that's not right. And that's disgusting. That's just, that's terrible. That's disgusting. Why would you do that? So stupid.
They literally thought from you're being a bad boy. Boom, disease. Got it.
Those doctors. Cholera didn't take many prisoners. Not even those at the top. Outgoing President James K. Polk supposedly contracted on his way home from Washington and passed away 3 months after he left office at the age of 53. Then-current President Zachary Taylor was also not totally immune to it. To those of you that don't already know, Zachary Taylor was our 12th president, serving from 1849 to 1850. You may be saying to yourself, presidents usually serve 4 years, right? Or 8 years, right? You'd be correct. They usually do, if they can survive. Zachary Taylor, unfortunately, did not last that long. Here's the story. On Independence Day 1850, President Taylor was out and about in Washington. After celebrating the holiday at the incomplete Washington Monument, the 65-year-old decided to walk for a few hours beneath the glaring sun before returning to the White House. When he got back, he decided to eat inhumane amounts of fruits and vegetables, including cherries, and down a gigantic jug of milk. Quick side note, Zachary Taylor must have been a superhero to do all that. I read a letter from one of his friends once that Taylor usually drank 2 gallons of water a day before dinner. And dinner was like at like 3 o'clock back then, so this is, you know, pretty crazy. I know that there are a lot of gym rats out there with those plastic milk cartons filled with water, but to do that in a time where diseases were just chilling out in the water supply, it takes a lot of guts. So kudos, old Zach. The combination of the raw produce and the contaminated White House water proved fatal on that day. Came down with intense cramps, and 5 days later, the President of the United States, Zachary Taylor, was no more. At that time in 1850, a year after the initial cholera outbreak, there weren't any signs that the disease would come back to Washington. There's no clear indication that Zachary Taylor actually died from cholera. But Taylor's death nevertheless ignited a period of mourning and panic in the nation's capital. Washingtonians were worried that they would be necked. Oh, necked.
We love when we're necked.
I feel like the show should just be me and you talking. This is just the first episode, folks.
There will be kinks to be worked out.
Washingtonians were worried that they would be next. Members of Congress, occupied with a compromise deal that would hopefully save the Union, were now petrified that they might meet that same fate that the president did. They monitored the papers closely for news and grew alarmed once the outbreak ravaged Harper's Ferry, a town less than 50 miles away. Worrisome congressmen wrote home about the chaos and confusion, fearing for their lives. Joshua Giddings, a representative from Ohio, told his daughter later in July that there is now considerable sickness. There have been several deaths. No one can have fruits or cucumbers. There is something in the atmosphere which renders them almost fatal. The government was even ready to halt their operations. Speaker of the House Howell Cobb noted the speed at which everything was moving and his eagerness to get back to Georgia to escape the dread. Looking back, we can actually see some similarities in the cholera outbreak and our situation today. In both instances, important events had to shut down. For instance, Ohio State Constitutional Convention in 1850 had to end early, quote, in consequence of the appearance of the cholera. Today, we can't watch March Madness or see who would win the NCAA college lacrosse championships, which personally makes me very sad. Though cholera never officially made it to Washington in the summer of 1850, the fear surrounding it caused things to actually get done on Capitol Hill for once. The Compromise of 1850 was quickly adopted in September after months of spirited debate, and the members of Congress were able to feel safe and secure back at home once again. Diseases have a way of doing that. In the time of political contention in our world today, did you see how quickly the President and Congress was able to make almost $1 trillion available to fight the economic implications of COVID-19? At least that is one plus about this whole situation. Disease is not a fun subject to discuss. But I wanted to look into the cholera outbreak of 1849 to underscore an important message for some of the doomsday predictors out there. cholera presented a multitude of threats to Americans in 1850, just like COVID-19 does today. It was a time of political turmoil, and many were uncertain of what the future held. But it's important to remember that they got through the pain and suffering then, and that we will get through this as well. This too shall pass. There are many things to be thankful for in the context of where we are today. We must be thankful that everyone is pulling their own weight to end this crisis. We must be thankful that we have doctors and medical personnel that are dedicating every ounce of their work and time into fighting this disease. And we must be thankful that they aren't telling us to use leeches to fight this. It's not good. Not good. At the end of the day, there's a new challenge to face with many changing dynamics. But if history teaches us anything, is that if we pull together as Americans and as citizens of the world, we can accomplish any feat. Cheers to that. Oh, God. Still doesn't smell good. Never mind. Before we wrap up this video, I want to try and get you guys involved in our show. From here on out, we're going to have Taylor Tuesdays, Fun Fact Fridays, and Storytime Sundays. So after this video is posted to YouTube, go to our story on our Instagram page, which is at the Zachary Taylor Project, and comment the names of three presidents that you would like to feature in Friday's episode. I will look over the responses and determine which three will have some interesting facts shared about them. For Storytime Sundays, I also want to hear your suggestions about a specific story that you would like me to tell about a certain president. You can either send me links to the information or write a story yourself, and I will feature one every Sunday from here on out. Please, 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 if you have any questions or any suggestions, either about Storytime Sundays, Fun Fact Fridays, Taylor Tuesdays, or the project itself, you can email me at cameron@thezacharytaylorproject.com, comment on this video below, or visit our website, www.thezacharytaylorproject.com. One last thing. For this series, we're going a little bit more in-depth into presidential history. But for kids, I'll be posting a quick video every Monday about something that helped me gain my love for presidents. Whether it be a book, video, documentary, or another item, I want to share the same love of learning that I was fortunate enough to get as a kid. Stay tuned for that next week. Thank you so much for watching this first episode of Fireside. I promise I'll try to keep the next one a little shorter for you all. Follow us on Instagram and Facebook with the handle @TheZacharyTaylorProject. Like this video and subscribe to our channel for some more amazing content, especially our new series on 19th century warfare, Taylor's Tales by Sam Hutchison. Feel free to comment below so we can make this channel even better. Be smart, be safe, and be thankful for your health. See you next time.